Good evening, everyone. I hope that you're all well. Thank you for joining us, those who are joining us on Zoom or on the APS Facebook page. This is the second edition of the APS Investment Chats. And our subject for today is sustainable investing. We have various experts in the field who will be giving us their, obviously, expert opinions, and I will be here to ask your questions. In fact, later on, you will be able to join us even via Zoom. You can put in your questions. Your contribution is actually very valid and very important to us. However, let us introduce our keynote speaker, Michael Tabone. Good evening, Michael. Michael is the portfolio manager at APS Bank. Joining is also Alison Abela, private clients relationship manager at APS Bank, of course. Joining us remotely, we have Steve Alloul, who's the advisor at Ministry for Energy, Enterprise and Sustainable Development. Hi, good evening, Steve. He is, as you can see, joining us via Zoom as well. And also Mr. Noel McCarthy, who is the chief investment officer at APS Bank. As I said, it will be Michael who will be introducing mainly this subject. However, please make notes, do contribute, do ask us your questions. Later on, you will be able to hear the answers, unless obviously throughout the conversation, Michael, Alison, Noel, or Steve will answer anything in particular. Mike, all yours.
Thanks very much, Stephanie. So as Stephanie said, I'll be going through a very short presentation on ESG investing, and then we'll open up for your questions later on at the end of the presentation. So let's start from the top. What is ESG investing? And I think the ESG investing can best be described as the practice of incorporating environmental, social, and governance attributes of a company into traditional investment analysis. So what this means is that ESG investing looks at companies from a different lens than traditional analysis. The E stands for environment, so that considers different attributes such as climate change, pollution, greenhouse gas emissions of different companies. The S stands for social, so that means the working conditions in a particular company, health and safety, gender diversity, as far as the employees are concerned, employee satisfaction. And then G stands for governance, which is concerns executive pay, bribery and corruption, even tax strategy of a particular company, whether that's a very aggressive tax strategy or not. So ESG should be considered as a complement to traditional fundamental investment analysis. I think what's important when considering ESG investing is that companies don't operate in a vacuum. Companies impact the environment and impact society, and society actually impacts companies and executives of companies on company boards and the decisions that they make. ESG investing, or sustainable investing as it's also commonly known as, concerns how companies make money and not just how much money companies make. So it's very much sort of concerning the process rather than just the output. And it's also a way of for shareholders and investors to align their values with their financial goals. And I think that's very important, and it is growing in importance, as we'll go into a little bit later. So, you know, just like consumers, I guess, adjust their consumption patterns or their spending patterns according to their values, just like they wouldn't, let's say, wear a fur coat, for example, or buy products that are tested on animals. This is a similar concept, but for investing. And actually, responsible investing isn't really something new. It can be traced back even back to the early 1970s with the launch of the PAX World Fund, which was the first socially responsible mutual fund launched in the US. There are many other sort of milestones, but I just want, on this slide, I just want to highlight two of them, which actually relate to my previous slide on how society can impact the decisions of different companies. In 1980, for example, there was a widespread divestment from South Africa in protest of apartheid. In 2003, GlaxoSmithKline actually was sort of pressured into cutting the price of HIV drugs due to campaigners and shareholders, or the actions of campaigners and shareholders. So I think that shareholders can make a big difference on the way that companies that companies operate. And this is what responsible investing is all about. Some other important milestones that I'll just touch on is the launch of the Principles for Responsible Investment, the PRI, in 2006 by the United Nations. It was a very important milestone. Signatories to the PRI have grown very significantly from when it was launched to now. And now there are, you know, tens of trillions of assets under management are actually sort of managers or signatories of the PRI. In 2008, we also had the first green bond. Now they're sort of quite popular. And in 2015, the United Nations set the Sustainable Development Goals. There were many other milestones along the way. So moving on, how to invest responsibly. So I think approaches to ESG investing are typically a combination of two areas, and these are not mutually exclusive. So most ESG managers would incorporate both areas into their investment process. One of them is ESG incorporation, which involves the integration of ESG, so systematically including ESG issues in your investment decision-making process. And then the screening. Screening is can both be positive screening or negative screening. The majority of people are aware of negative screening. What that means is that different investment managers would rule out investing in certain industries or in certain companies that do not align with their values. For example, ruling out from their investment universe tobacco stocks, for example, or companies that produce weapons is another example. And then you've got thematic investing, which is essentially seeking to maximize return, but with the intention to contribute to a specific ESG outcome. So for example, investing in a solar farm, for example, you could still make money out of that and it could still be a good investment, but at the same time, you're contributing to an ESG outcome or an ESG goal. And then on the right-hand side of the slide, you can see that the other area is around active ownership and stewardship. And this involves engagement with company management to try and push them or give them the incentive to, to change their ways or to change the ways of the companies that they are running with a focus on ESG. And then there's proxy voting. So voting, shareholders need to vote according to their values as well. And I think if we consider sort of why one should invest responsibly, I think there are three sort of pillars here. Obviously there's the sort of moral reasons as to why one should invest responsibly, but there are also many financial reasons. And I actually, in my presentation, focus mostly on the financial reasons, or I make that argument that investing responsibly is not just about morality or about values, but it also adds shareholder value too. And I think there are three overarching areas. So there's client demand, and we see this ourselves as well, that clients are demanding more and more transparency from, they want to know where their money is going and where they are investing. Materiality is another one, meaning that there's a lot of recognition that ESG is important and is important to risk return. And I'll go through a little bit of this later on. And the third one is regulation. And regulation globally is giving or pushing companies and stakeholders to adopt ESG in their investment practices and in their investment process. So there are other reasons, so focusing on the financial, ESG controversies cost a lot of money. So in the past 6 years, just in the US, there's been more than $500 billion of value has been lost due to these controversies. Some examples, not just in the past 6 years, but some that many of you may be familiar with, was in 2010, for example, we saw the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, which was a big natural disaster and cost BP, apart from the huge reputational damage, cost them just under $54 billion in a pre-tax charge. In 2015, most would be aware of the VW scandal, whereby Volkswagen rigged 11 million diesel vehicles to pass emission tests. That cost them just under $30 billion in fines alone. And some of the effect of that is still being felt indirectly today. And then more recently in 2018 with the Facebook scandal, which affected with Cambridge Analytica and affected more than 87 million different Facebook users. But there are also some more positive reasons as to why you should care about ESG when making investment decisions. One of them is to avoid bankruptcy. This is an interesting statistic from Bank of America Merrill Lynch, whereby between 2005 and 2015, had investors screened for companies that do not rank highly in terms of ESG or do not score highly, then they would have avoided 90% of bankruptcies. I think that's an important statistic. So you can avoid, the message is that you can avoid some serious downside risk by avoiding the bad companies, if you like. I won't go into too much detail on the left-hand side, but basically what it's saying is that intangibles, so things that cannot easily be explained or analyzed in using traditional investment analysis have become more important in terms of companies' balance sheets. And therefore, we require a different approach to analyze companies as well. And on the right-hand side, you can see that the companies that actually rank worst in terms of ESG or controversies, companies that pollute more, companies that don't have good employee relations, for example, those actually experience much more earnings volatility. Volatility is a measure of risk in financial markets. And vice versa, the best companies tend to experience the least amount of volatility. I mentioned earlier that client demand is driving the growth of ESG investing, and this is quite significant. So to put some numbers to that, in 2018, assets under management, so assets managed by investment managers, through funds, were around $500 billion in terms of size. And now, as of the end of the first quarter 2021, this has reached close to $2 trillion and is set to continue to grow. This is actually an area where Europe is leading the way globally, where most of the ESG funds are coming out of Europe. But that's not to say that the US and other countries aren't catching up. I think it's important that demographics will be important for ESG investing and sustainable investing in general going forward. If you take three bellwether demographic segments, so women, millennials, and high net worth individuals, these are three very important for the future of investing. You can see that the majority of them either currently own or are interested in adding ESG assets. So this is important, especially for millennials. So you can see that millennials actually care a lot about investing responsibly and globally. And so why does that matter to us? I think that matters to us because millennials are going to end up with all or a significant amount of global wealth. Millennials will own five times as much wealth in 2030 than they had in 2018. And if that's where all the money is and they're going to be investing according to their values, then this is certainly going to become more and more important. There are other more positive reasons, like ESG can lower funding costs for companies. So not only should investors care about ESG, but companies should do so also indirectly. So here, what we're seeing, I won't go into too much detail here, but basically on the right-hand side, you can see that the companies that score highest in terms of ESG have the lowest cost of debt. So it is cheaper for them to issue debt funding. And on the left-hand side, you can see that from an equity perspective, equity funding is also cheaper for companies that score well on ESG. In terms of a social factor, so employee satisfaction, I came across some of these statistics and I thought it'd be interesting. What it shows is that happy workers pay for companies. Glassdoor is an international ratings website where employees can go and rate their current and their former employers. And what it shows is that companies that actually rank well in terms of employee satisfaction, that translates over time into shareholder value. I think that's important. So there's more than just these past couple of slides have been making the argument that basically there's more than just the moral reason to invest responsibly. There are also some good financial reasons to do so. Gender equality is another important one for various different reasons, but it's just the quantum which is really important here. And according to McKinsey, closing the gender gap could deliver up to 28 trillion of additional GDP in 2025. And this was a theoretical exercise that they carried out, but it just highlights the importance or the potential importance of some of these ESG factors and addressing them carefully and properly. This is a huge number. It's equivalent to the combined US and China economies today. So although this in practice might never reach fruition, but there's a lot of potential there. And board diversity, which is a governance factor, right, in the ESG acronym. This is also interesting that according to Bank of America, diversity signaled lower earnings volatility, so lower risk, and higher return on equity. So if you have a diverse board for most listed companies, that will also translate into more profitability and less volatility. There's more to go, and a lot of companies still have a lot to do from the private sector. The graph on the left represents the US, and it's as of 2019, where only 25% of boards of large companies in the S&P 500 are represented by women or women on the board. And on the left-hand side, you can see that companies that have a higher percentage of women on the board and women managers tend to have a higher return on equity. And lastly, I'll close this presentation with something that, I skipped the slide, something that's often asked to us and is on a lot of investors' minds, and that's, do ESG strategies impact investor returns? So do I give up some kind of future earning potential by investing responsibly? We get this question a lot. And historically speaking, the answer to that question is no. The reality is that ESG ranked companies actually outperform non-ESG or ESG companies that don't rank so well from an ESG perspective. And do they do that by adding more risk? And in fact, the data seems to show that there isn't any geographic concentration in that. And ESG focus does not mean that you need to give up any earnings. And actually, it doesn't mean that you're taking more risk or more volatility, at least historically speaking. That was my brief sort of introduction to ESG and to sustainable investing. And thanks very much for listening. And I think we can.
It was great, actually.
Back to you, Stephanie.
I enjoyed every second of it. I found it very, very interesting. You actually concluded on the risk factor, which interests anyone out there who's. I mean, I could be a potential investor. So obviously, my first question would be, and that perhaps I could direct to you, Noel, whether something like this would be more risky than the normal funds. I mean, when I heard Michael talking about it, I said, well, this would be the really right thing to do. But there again, the money that I have, I worked hard for. So would I be risking more?
Yes, you're right there. A company with a low ESG rating generally has a higher risk than the entire fines, reputation risk as a result of weak governance structure. However, this does not mean that all companies which have a high ESG rating have a low risk profile. Especially if we're talking about funds, the funds invest according to their objective, which is governed by the prospectus. So just to give you an example, an ESG fund which invests in investment grade bonds has a lower risk profile when compared to another ESG fund which invests in equities.
So the client can actually decide or ask specifically for what kind of risk the person wants to take, right?
Yes. In fact, the client, the investment service advisor, should guide the client to invest depending on his risk profile,
okay,
on what type of risk he would like to take.
Fantastic. Alison, in fact, now we'll just refer to your role. Performance of ESG investments, mm-hmm, compared then to the broader stock markets, perhaps the ones we're more familiar with.
Okay. So many people might actually think that investing sustainably or choosing ESG investing might come, but you might lose some performance. You might need to sacrifice some returns for it. However, there have actually been many investments, especially in the past decade, that have actually outperformed the traditional funds, traditional investments. We have seen that there has been heightened awareness when in topics such as climate change, gender equality, other issues which Michael was mentioning earlier. And this might have led to investors opting to invest on a more moral level, maybe.
Okay.
Fast forward to last year and the COVID pandemic, we have seen that ESG investing have outperformed even big indices like the S&P 500, for example.
Is it the younger generation, like Michael?
Well, most probably ESG investments have a larger chunk of investments in technology. And obviously, they made quite some gains during the pandemic. But actually, there is nothing showing that once you go into sustainable investing, you have to let go of some performance or some returns.
Okay, so you suggest that you'd have maybe the traditional, in fact, even
a combination of both.
Like you'd have the traditional investment, and then this would enhance what you would already have. Great. Steve, hi, and good evening. In your opinion, how prepared are the Maltese companies to sustainable investments and also to a greener business model?
Good evening. Allow me, Stephanie, to congratulate APS and to commend APS for being really at the forefront of ESG investing in Malta and really pushing the agenda forward in terms of sustainable investing, something which we really need to push forward in our country. We've been sensing locally an increasing appetite towards sustainable investing. Particularly, not exclusively, but particularly from the younger generation, millennials, as Mr. Tabone correctly pointed out in his presentation. But we've also seen a lot of institutional investors locally being very, very sensitive into ensuring that their capital is invested into sustainable assets. So this is something which is very much core to the investment decision-making process all over the globe, particularly in Europe, but also in the US. And we're seeing a lot of institutional clients and institutional investors here in Malta ensuring that sustainable investing is part of their portfolio requirements, of their investment horizon and their investment objectives. So something which is very critical. In Malta, we really want to push forward, and I think it's very critical to push forward the agenda in terms of corporate investing. So companies investing in their own ESG requirements. And that's something which I think is critical for us as a country to be able to achieve our carbon neutrality objective and attain our ambitious program in that sense. We're seeing a lot of positive appetite emanating from companies, ensuring that they want to invest in sustainable investing. On the other side, we have a lot of companies in Malta, which are quoted companies, listed companies, Which still need to step up their game, in my opinion, if you ask me, in terms of ESG. We have some companies which are pretty much at the forefront. MIA is one of them. MIA has been reporting, has been issuing sustainable reporting for the last 5 years now. Since 2015, they've been issuing these sustainable reports with very clear ESG KPIs. They actually measure the CO2 impact per passenger passing through the local airport. We have other companies doing that as well. But then we are sensing that there needs to be an element of handholding, an element of awareness that needs to sink through in other listed companies. And I'm mentioning listed companies because these are crucial in order to, on the other hand, to increase awareness at the investor level, because Maltese investors can actually invest in ESG companies, and they can do it through funds, as the presentation was highlighting. They can do it through investing directly in international assets, but we'd like Maltese investors to invest locally in ESG companies. And in order to do so, we are pushing forward some very interesting initiatives in this ESG space. We're enabling companies, Maltese companies, to publish, to showcase their commitment towards ESG. And we have a lot of Maltese companies, not just listed ones, but even companies in the manufacturing industry, for example, who have been investing strategically and with a significant magnitude in their environmental impact, in reducing their CO2 emissions. We have other companies which have been investing in the social side. And we would like them to showcase what they've been doing through sustainable reporting. But we want investors to be able to assess that information, and in order to assess whether they would like to invest in company A or company B, not just because of future returns, but also because of the ESG commitments of those companies. And we're seeing this appetite from companies and investors, and would like to push it further, because it's something which is critical, and it's something which enables investors to make money while they do good in their country.
So you're saying that the investors are sensitive. However, I'm not sure whether there is enough access to the information, especially locally, Steve, because you're saying that they are obviously trying their utmost and there seems to be a lot of interest, but about the personal investor, is he aware enough?
I think the real problem lies into the fact that many Maltese companies, let me focus on the listed ones, because the listed companies, any investor could buy shares or bonds in those listed companies. Maltese listed companies, we have this, I wouldn't call it anomaly, it's a reflection of our corporate environment. Many Maltese companies are really and truly SMEs. Even the listed companies, many of them are small or medium-sized enterprises. And up till today, the regulation, and Mr. Tabona was mentioning this before, the regulation, the non-financial disclosure regulation, doesn't cover small and medium-sized enterprises. It obliges companies which employ more than 500 employees to publish their ESG reporting, but not the smaller ones or the medium-sized companies. So what is happening in Malta is that those companies who publish this kind of data are doing so because they are the largest companies. Now, regulation will come into force in the coming months, which will extend this requirement, this regulatory requirement for companies to issue and to publish their ESG commitment to all listed companies. We will have like 40,000 or 50,000 companies all over Europe that will need to publish this data from the current 12,000 or so companies at this moment in time. So this will require basically all local listed companies, whether they have shares or bonds issued in the local market, to not just showcase, but to actually invest in their ESG criteria. And that, in my opinion, Stephanie, that will shift the focus of Maltese companies from CSR, from doing good through initiatives like corporate social responsibility, which is important, but shifting that towards ESG, which is pretty much incorporating the environment awareness and the social awareness of companies within the operating model itself. So the board of directors would decide, and the CEO would decide whether to invest in new machinery, for example, depending on whether that machinery has an element of energy efficiency, for example, whether to invest in solar farms, which would reduce the CO2 emissions, but also the costs of the company and increase the profitability. And I think this, and I conclude here, I think this really hits home on the fact that ESG actually is not just about being environmental friendly, not just about being socially sensitive, which are very, very important factors. But ESG is also about increasing profitability of companies, because if you're investing in a solar farm, for example, which reduces the energy costs year in, year out, then there is potential for an increased return on equity for investors.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. I look forward to hearing more about this, even obviously on our local media, because we need it to be out there. We need more people to know about it. And in fact, Mike, if I may, we're obviously speaking favorably about it, but I'm sure there are challenges, because nothing, usually we have pros and cons. What challenges do you see that it's exposed to?
Yes, no, absolutely. I think that's a really important question. I think Steve actually mentioned a couple of challenges, and one of them is this, I would say, is disclosure. We need companies to disclose more information, and not just because they are mandated by the regulations, which are also important because they're pushing investors in the right, they're pushing companies in the right direction, but also it should come from stakeholders, from shareholders demanding it as well. So I think disclosure is one big challenge that we need to, and we're heading in the right direction. And that's especially sort of locally, but it's somewhat of an issue internationally as well. There are other issues such as sometimes I think maybe possibly ESG is used a little bit too much from a marketing perspective, for example, where people on paper or investment managers on paper consider it a bit of a box ticking exercise. I think the implementation is very important as well.
Like a buzzword kind of, like we're talking everything sustainable, so let's go for it.
Right. Okay. So and I think the third point is, which is related to that, is consistency. So, and this is more from an international perspective, but you could, because the criteria are still somewhat subjective at this point in time, you could run into a situation where one company is rated quite highly by one analyst, for example, on ESG,
okay,
and then a different analyst looks at it slightly differently or has different weights for different
But that's where
factors.
You come in, right?
Exactly.
You can guide accordingly,
exactly.
Then, and obviously,
right.
Also.
But that's also, I think, a challenge. I think it would be good if we had more maybe consistent criteria that we could compare different companies against each other on.
Great, thank you. We're going to start asking the questions which you kindly asked, so please keep them coming. The first one is addressed to you, Noel, and the question is it enough to just consider ESG factors when analyzing an investment?
ESG would be the first screen. However, this has to be followed by traditional investment analysis. The value of a company depends on the capability to generate future cash flow. The more cash flow that the company is capable to generate, the higher would be the value of the company.
Okay. So obviously, yes.
And ESG is the first, is the filter, the first filter, let's call it so.
Okay. Alison. Where should one keep his emergency fund so that inflation doesn't eat it year by year? Oh, that's interesting. Okay.
So I see a bit of a contradiction, if I may, here, mm-hmm. because when it comes to emergency funds, inflation is not a priority. So when you want to keep emergency funds, you need them to be accessible at any time, at any point. And obviously, if you're going to go for an investment, it's either going to be tied down for some years, or else you can have fluctuation in value. So the most commonly used emergency product would be a basic savings account.
Okay.
Having said that, emergency funds are normally not more than 3 to 6 months worth of salary. So it's not going to be a huge chunk, which one should keep as emergency funds.
May I ask a question? I mean, I've been asking questions, but this is more personal enough. Do you have to be wealthy to invest in these funds? I mean, is it accessible to anyone with a normal pay?
Yes. Okay. Actually, I mean, it is very easy to start off investing any age. Normally, I mean, from the younger generation to pensioners, you can start off with investing monthly if you'd wish. So a small amount, €50 a month would be sufficient.
Okay, so you don't need big thousands like
No.
Okay, very cool. Good. Okay, more questions, because otherwise I get carried away asking mine. What do you think are the biggest challenges faced by investment managers when incorporating ESG into the investment process? Michael.
I think this was actually very similar to the previous question. I think the challenges faced are around consistency, disclosure. I think those are two very important points, and then also greenwashing. So, I mean, as in trying differentiating between different companies based on their disclosures. And I think a lot is happening in this regard. And I think in a few years' time, a lot of these challenges will be addressed, either by stakeholders putting pressure on companies, but also through regulations as well.
Yeah. And I'm assuming that most of the normal companies who haven't started on this road yet will eventually follow as well.
Absolutely.
Because they see the trend, right? I mean, the trend is that everyone's becoming more sustainable. And like Steve said before, it is also self-help. If you invest in solar panels, for example, you're obviously decreasing your output. So yeah, I guess it makes sense that
people
will follow. So Steve, may I call you in, please? We have a question for you. How is policy and regulation being shaped to enable companies and investors to embed ESG in their decision making? Are you still with us, Steve? Yes, there he is.
Yes, I think, locally, policy is pretty much driving this ESG investing, I have to say. And it's something which we're doing because we're very passionate about the subject, but it's something which is not really normal, because usually ESG is not driven by government policy itself. Usually it's driven by the industry. And this is what happened in more developed markets all over Europe. But at this moment in time, the government policy is driving sustainable investing from a twofold approach. First of all, by assisting Maltese companies, local companies, whether listed or not, to invest in sustainable projects. There is a €15 million fund, I mean, just one of the schemes, which really and truly incentivizes and directly funds Maltese companies, their projects that relate exclusively to energy efficiency. So if they need to change their machinery, their equipment, if they want to install PV farms, there's a €15 million budget which exclusively funds these kind of investment. And we've also seen other investments locally, other incentives for corporate investment in feed-in tariffs, for example, which is a critical investment for us as a country to achieve our CO2 objectives and carbon neutrality objectives. That's one side of the story. The other side of the story, I think, and it's something very, very innovative that we're doing locally, is to enable Maltese companies that are actually investing in their ESG credentials to showcase this to investors and to potential investors, whether locally or abroad. And indeed, very recently we've launched these initiatives, which within 3 months will collect data from all Maltese listed companies. That data will be brought together, collated, and made public, so that Maltese and international investors could access the data and would know whether company A is doing compared to company B, and direct the capital, direct their money towards one company or the other, also depending on the ESG commitment of those companies. So this approach, I wouldn't call it, it's a double carrot approach, because there's no stick in it. Really and truly, the government is funding from one side, but also enabling and enhancing awareness and visibility on the other side. That's, I think, very, very important. And one thing which I'd like to mention on this point, Maltese companies being a frontier market, our market is what it is, a small market, pretty much a frontier market in all its dynamics. actually requires and necessitates information in order to attract investors. In the first quarter, in the first 3 months of 2021, we've seen 2 billion euros daily, 2 billion, so 2,000 million euros of money across Europe flowing into ESG companies. That's half, and that's on a daily basis, that's half the capitalization, the net worth of all the Maltese listed companies. So imagine what we could do in this country, in our stock exchange, if we could attract even a fraction of that ESG fund flow into Maltese companies. And that's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to give visibility to these companies in order for them to be able to attract local investors, local retail investors, but also institutional ones, but also foreign investor, why not? And there is no way, and as Michael was mentioning before, ESG is such an important factor in the investment decision-making of international asset managers that there is no way a Maltese company, be it small or large, can attract any international funding unless it is committed and also showcasing its ESG requirement.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Another one for you, Michael. Mr. Tabone, how is the ESG score calculated? And what is an ESG score, if you don't mind?
Sure. Yes, that's a good question. Essentially, even before the scoring stage, I could say sort of how we carry out this process. We also filter companies in terms of the negative screening criteria, as I mentioned before in my presentation. So we would automatically exclude from our investment universe certain companies that are involved in, we have six negative screening criteria, such as tobacco, the production of alcohol, for example, or the production or distribution of weapons. And then following that, most ESG scoring, and what that means is essentially saying how companies rank. It's a ranking system.
Okay. All right.
Relative to each other.
So points, yes, and points, like points, no, and obviously exactly. Then you deduct and then,
right.
Okay.
But there isn't like one standard ESG scoring system. So some companies would score it based on letters, for example, A, B, C, so similar to the credit scoring agencies or the credit rating agencies. And then some other companies give a numerical score out of 100. Essentially what it is it's a weighted average of the individual components of the individual attributes. And most of the scoring is done in that way.
Noel, could you tell us about the ethical investment fund of APS? As if I'm not mistaken, that is concerned with sustainable investment, right?
Yes, correct.
Okay.
Basically, our ethical fund has the same criteria which Michael explained. Basically, before we invest in any securities, we rate the companies and we give them a score, and we invest only in securities which have high ESG rating. And we use the same criteria which Michael explained. Basically, we filter first those companies that do not follow certain objectives. So, for example, you have the tobacco, pornography, weapons, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Those are eliminated automatically. And then we have a rating agency, an international company, which assists us in rating all the companies which are part of the portfolio. And we invest only in those companies which have high rating in ESG. Obviously, as I explained before, that is the first screening. Then the portfolio managers will start the traditional investment analysis to select the best companies which we expect that they will continue performing or improve their performance.
Another question, is it for Michael? Or yeah. I believe you had one for Alison. Okay, Michael, we're attacking you a bit. Do you only look at the ESG score of the mother corporation or also those of the subsidiaries?
That's also another good question. But just to add to what Noel was saying first on the previous question, we also, apart from looking at individual companies, we also look at countries as well. And I think that's just important to highlight that we look at different countries and score them based on their, for example, their corruption index or whether they are classified as being free countries. And we would only invest in those countries. So we exclude certain companies from certain countries as well.
Okay.
So just to add to that point. The question now was on subsidiaries or the holding companies. The reality is it depends. I mean, usually we look at, if the holding company is the listed entity, there are situations where both the holding company and the subsidiary are both listed, in which case, if we're investing in the subsidiary, we would look at that, but would still take into consideration other related investments as well. If the holding company is listed, then that would, our analysis would also incorporate the subsidiaries.
Okay, so you do it thoroughly, so kind of, you don't...
Exactly, yeah.
Alison, where can one find the ESG rating of a fund?
So when it comes to mutual funds, normally there are standard documents like the fact sheets or the key investor information document. Those normally hold ESG ratings. Yeah. In addition to that, when it comes to sustainable mutual funds, normally there is also the ethical policy.
Okay.
And there, it is normally also listed there.
And it's easily accessible, I'm
assuming. Yes. Okay. Normally on the website, it's okay. Going to be there. Yeah.
Steve, I think you've already referred to this question. However, I'll put it forward. What incentives can the government give for companies to focus on ESG? I believe you mentioned quite a number of millions, which sounded very pleasant.
Yes, indeed. As we discussed before, the idea is to support companies from both sides of the spectrum, providing financing and assistance, and very aggressive assistance, if I may, in their investment in ESG. At this moment in time, we have another scheme coming up. We're working on it, and it's pretty much on the pipeline, which would be the Smart and Sustainability Scheme, which will have a blend of tax credits, but also of cash grants, which will enable more investment to sustainability by Maltese companies. But most of all, I would reiterate, because I think it's very important, the element of visibility, assisting Maltese companies in being aware, first of all, because I feel many companies, even listed ones, still need some awareness assistance, but also being able into assisting them to actually showcase what they are doing. I'm scrolling through the Q&A. I think something which is also very, very sensitive to this subject is the notion of green bonds, for example. We're speaking about equities, but I think before there was a mention on bonds. Green bonds could be another important vehicle which channels money, investors' money, into companies which are sensitive to green projects. And we have a framework here in Malta. Back in January, we've issued the Green Bond Framework here in Malta. So today, companies and even the Maltese government itself can issue bonds. And we know how much these bonds are important for Maltese investors. But these bonds would be green bonds, and therefore the proceeds from these bonds would flow into green projects. I think this is something which is very important. The framework is there. We have it. The government has been issuing this through Malta Stock Exchange. So the tools are there. It's up for us to use them.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Steve Alul. It's been a pleasure having you with us. We appreciate your contribution immensely. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
I am concluding with Steve. However, this is the end of the conversation. It seems that we've covered most of the questions. However, you still have the possibility of learning more. In fact, if you are on Zoom, on Facebook, you can follow. You have over there, you have the list in front of you. You have a question. Would you like to discuss further with our investment advisors? If yes, obviously you tick yes. If no, obviously you tick no. May I remind you that those who would like to follow up might be given further offers, so it is a good opportunity to learn more about the subject presently, even whilst APS are doing these special incentives for you. So just tick the box, right or left. In the meantime, I thank you, Michael. It's been a great pleasure listening and learning. Honestly, I feel like I've learned a lot. Noel, thank you. Alison, hope you have a very lovely evening. Our appointment with you is for tomorrow. Same time, same place, 6 p.m. We'll be on Zoom, we'll be on Facebook. Kindly join us if you're not, if you want to even join us with Zoom. You can also go on to apsbank.com.mt/chats, and over there you'll find all the info necessary. So may you all have a lovely evening. Think and dream of investments. In the meantime, take care of yourselves, and we'll see you tomorrow.